I hope this will do. I said thank for inviting me, and we first give an outline of my presentation. First, we will discuss symbol sense and the lack of symbol sense with many students, and then something about graphing formulas. Then we will give an impression of the intervention in grade 11 about graphing formulas to qualitative reasoning and recognition, which we call the GQR design. Then an impression of the instruments, analysis and results. And let's first state the conclusion. I think graphing formulas to qualitative reasoning and recognition might be a practical means to teach symbol sense systematically. And we finish with some discussion. Well, first, what are the problems? Well, many students lack symbol sense and have little confidence in their own algebraic reasoning. Let's see, for instance, here at the right, you see a formula, and when we are looking at it, our concept image will have something like, it's a 7 minus a quadratic form. So 7 minus something positive or zero. So the maximum value will be 7. When x is minus 5, the graph will be a parabola with a turning point at x is minus 5 and y is 7. And when we solve equations, we consider whether or not to expand the brackets. Well, at the bottom, you see that students mix up a lot of things. It has something to do with 5 and 7, then you see. But was it minus 5 or minus 7? Or, well, probably they will recognize a parabola, but still they have a lot of problems to read through this kind of formulas. The second problem is that we don't know exactly how to teach symbol sense systematically. And our focus will be on students in grade 11 and 12. Another example of a lack of symbol sense, you have to turn your head a little bit. This student in grade 11, a good achieving student, is trying to graph these formulas. And you see the first formula, she was a girl, she discovered that when x is 3, y is minus 9. So you see the point here, but she don't know the rest of the graph. The second one is a decreasing exponential function. Well, here you see it is decreasing, but it's intersecting the x-axis. And the third one is about the natural logarithm, but she don't know the prototypical graph of a natural logarithm. And she makes some calculations. This one is not correct, but this is correct. But it doesn't lead to anything. Another example of a lack of symbol sense, and well, here's the question, give the number of solutions of this equation. And of course we know this isn't possible to solve algebraically. And this student makes some calculations, correct calculations, but it doesn't help him. And he himself say, well, do I make any progress? And well, x in the power of 5 can be positive or negative, but it doesn't lead to anything. What is symbol sense? Well, symbol sense is a very broad concept. It's involved in all, well, not all, but many phases of the problem solving cycle, starting with a problem, the realistic problem in real world, then a mathematical problem, then the mathematical solution, and the real world solution. And symbol sense is involved in these phases. This is a figure from Pierce and Stacey. And Arkavi was one of the first who was talking about symbol sense. And he said it has to do with a feeling of when and how to use symbols and when to abandon a symbolic representation. Paul Drijver sees symbol sense as complementary to basic skills. In this model, symbol sense is about taking a global view, algebraic reasoning, working with strategy, whereas basic skills is more about calculations, a local focus, and procedural work. When working, for instance, with brackets, expanding brackets is a basic skill, but when to expand brackets or when not is a matter of symbol sense. Piers and Stacy described symbol sense in this phase from mathematical problem to the mathematical solution in a framework with identification of structure, of key features, and of linking representations. Well, I said already, symbol sense is a very broad concept and difficult to teach. And our focus was on reading through formulas and making sense of formulas. So not all the symbol sense, but only on these aspects. And we used the term insight into algebraic formulas. And that's about recognizing the structure of a formula and its components, and to reason with and about formulas. And this led to our main research question, how to teach these aspects of symbol sense systematically to students in grade 11 and 12. Well, first, get a feeling of what formulas by hand is. Consider your strategies for some moments when I ask you to graph these both formulas. So I will stop 1 minute. Give you some time.
Nice to hear that some people actually intensively draw them.
Excellent. Okay, before discussing the strategies, now I miss very much the physics environment. We talk about why graphing formulas by hand. Kirin and Redford already suggested that to make sense of formulas, we can use realistic contexts and multiple representations. Well, for linear and exponential functions, it's easy to link them to realistic contexts. But for many other formulas, that's quite difficult. So we choose to link formulas to graphs to enable students to make sense of formulas. And of course, then technology helps in learning about functions and about linking formulas to graphs. But Goldenberg already found that the connection between formula and graphs is established more effectively when graphing is done by hand. And we get this overview and graphing formulas. Let's first look at the product. What do we get? We get a link between formula and graph. And graphs seem to be more accessible for people. When you look, for instance, at the newspaper, you see graphs, but you hardly see any formulas. Graphs stresses the object character. Of course, we know learning about functions is learning about process and object duality, and seeing a function both as an input-output machine and as an object. And the graph stresses the object character. And of course, the graph gives instant information about the covariation, how the dependent and independent variables are covari. And that is very important in learning about calculus. How to graph formulas, I will come to that in a minute. Well, let's go back to your strategies of graphing both formulas. I think the second one, you probably instantly recognize a function family, but the first one might be more complicated. What are the possibilities? Well, it is possible when seeing a formula like this, you instantly know the graph, or you instantly recognize it as a member of a function family. And you know it's something like this. For instance, it's the cost supply functions, which were in the math curriculum, math A curriculum several years ago, always look like this kind of formulas. It is also possible that you did not recognize the function family, but you recognize two different basic functions. Y is 2x and y is 4 divided by x. And you graph both functions, and then you have to add the graphs. Or it is possible, and then we come to D1, that you instantly recognize some of the key features. For instance, this one has a slant asymptote and, of course, a vertical asymptote. And that's the start for further exploration. It's also possible that there is no recognition of the graph whatsoever, and then you can start a strategic exploration, for instance, looking at the tails of the graph. And then you get reasoning like when x is very large, it's going to infinity, 4 divided by x is almost zero, so the graph can be approximated by y is 2x. And also when x is going to minus infinity, we have the same thing. And when looking at the graph in the neighborhood of x is zero, when x is a little bit larger than zero, then the 4 divided by x is very large. The 2x is almost zero, can be neglected. And then we get right of the y-axis is very large outcomes. And when x is very a little bit smaller than zero, then we get negative, very negative outcomes, and it's down here. And this kind of reasoning we called qualitative reasoning. It's a kind of global reasoning with global descriptions and ignoring what is not relevant in the problem situation. Here in this situation, for instance, was it important? If it was saying here 40 or 400 or 25, we would have done the same reasoning. Of course, it's important that it's a positive number. Well, in qualitative reasoning is a very important thing and hardly thought in, explicitly thought in secondary school. Back to the levels of recognition, it's also possible that there's no recognition at all and no strategic exploration, and then you can only calculate some points. And these levels of recognition were used in a framework, a two-dimensional framework we developed. And here in the first column, you see these levels of recognition. And on several levels, we added some heuristics, strong heuristics, like, it's, for instance, a natural logarithm translated to the right. It's a strong heuristic, or a qualitative reasoning, which I show you in the previous slide, about infinity behavior. Strong heuristics give information about large parts of the graph, whereas, for instance, calculation of a point only give local information, and that's why we call this a weak heuristic. This framework was used to describe expert strategies in graphing formulas. And these form the base of our intervention. Now we give you an impression of the intervention. We had 21 students in grade 11, and we had a series of 5 lessons of 90 minutes. in which we taught graphing formulas through qualitative reasoning and recognition. And often they work in pairs and or in groups of three. And we had in every lesson a small introduction, plenary discussion of about 10 minutes max. Well, we focus on teaching a repertoire of basic function families with prototypes and key features for the recognition, and on explicitly teaching qualitative reasoning. And graphing formulas can be considered as a complex skill because there are many, many, many formulas, and therefore we use whole tasks with help and reflection. And we introduced the meta-heuristic questioning the formula. That's that students started to question what do I recognize, and not instantly start with calculations. So considering their strategies. And we developed five whole tasks reflecting the levels of recognition. And here at the bottom you see the whiteboard after a plenary discussion in the second lesson. We give an impression of the whole task. Task one is about matching basic formulas, prototypes of basic functions and their graph. So linking these formulas to the graph. In the reflection, we stimulated students to find ways to express the graphs with their arms, make gestures, and we demonstrated several times during the plenary discussion. And later in our series of lessons, we saw students using these gestures to indicate how the graph goes. The second task was based on Burkhardt and Swan, who often use problems like what's the same and what's different. And our focus was here on the minus sign, on reverse and prototypical graphs. And for instance, here, the second, the influence of the minus on the prototypical graph 3 in the power x, and the influence of this minus sign. We started already here with some qualitative reasoning, because in the first two formulas, when this 2 was, for instance, minus 25, and this one again minus 25, we should have used the same arguments for getting the global shape of the graph of these formulas. Task 3 was about decomposing the formula and composing the subgraphs. So again, here we graph the square root of x, and then x in the power 2 minus 4, and then try to multiply both graphs. Task 4 was about recognizing key features, for instance, extreme values, vertical asymptotes, zeros, and we gave the same function, we got two different formulas, and the graph, and the question was, what can you read from the formula? What kind of information does the formula give you instantly about the graph? Task 5 focused on qualitative reasoning. For instance, what happens in the tails of the graph, so infinity behavior. And then we get reasoning like when x is very large, this part is almost zero, then this part is almost zero, so c becomes about 52.7. And of course, we can reason whether or not this function is constantly increasing or decreasing. That's a kind of qualitative reasoning as well. Of course, it's important reasoning about what are the stronger and weaker elements in a function. For instance, here, when x is very large, this will be very large, but this will be very small. So, which one is stronger? So that's are things in qualitative reasoning as well. Well, some kind of overview. So the upper part we already discussed, the lower part, how to graph formulas. So focus on recognition of function families and key features, on qualitative reasoning, on questioning the formula. So what do I recognize? Using whole tasks with help and reflection, and working in pairs. And because some of the reasoning is very new, modeling expertise in the plenary discussion at the start of the lesson, for instance, how you can use qualitative reasoning. Then the impression of the instruments we were using. We had three written tests: pre-test, post-test, and retention test. Retention test was 4 months later, after the summer break. In those three tests, we had every time at least two tasks with more or less the same formulas. Task one was about graphing, 7 simple basic functions and 7 more complex functions. And here you get an impression of what we call basic functions. And these are examples of more complex functions. We had a multiple choice task with 20 graphs and one alternative, none of these, and with 14 formulas, students had to indicate which graph belongs to the formula. In the pretest and post-test, we had a questionnaire and a card sorting test. And the card sorting test asked students to categorize 40 formulas like these in as many categories as they wanted, with categorize the formulas according to their rough graph. So formulas which had more or less the same graph should put together. In the pre-test and post-test, we had 6 students who were asked to think aloud during the graphing task. Well, this slide you already saw, but I have some other. Let's see. This one. Okay, we saw a student working on this, basic function, and we heard her doing some qualitative reasoning, especially in the end when she was discussing the role of the tree, but she mixed up exponential functions with power functions. Back to the The videos were transcribed and encoded with the following codebook. They were using function families and a prototypical graph, we code P. When recognizing a key feature F, part graph exploration was about discussing larger parts of the graph, often with qualitative reasoning, and we coded when calculations were made. This one, student M, sketching this graph, you already saw the results, because probably you recognize this phrase. And she couldn't, she didn't know the prototype. She didn't know how to proceed. And student K was a high achieving student, and she didn't recognize the prototypical natural logarithm graph either, but she was able to use reasoning to make a correct graph. So probably you read this for a moment. In the pretest, we found that the students had a lot of problems with recognizing basic functions, and of course, qualitative reasoning was a problem as well. It was also when they succeed, it was very time-consuming business. In the post-test, they used more recognition, and you see, for instance, this student. When working on this graph, it goes downwards, zeros at 0, 2, and 5. At x is 1, it's negative, and make a correct graph. And this student, using the decomposition strategy, first graphing y is 2x, then graphing the square root of x plus 6, and then multiply the two graphs. These findings were confirmed by the scores we had. The mean score in the pretest was only 3 out of 14. In the post-test, it was more than 9 out of 14. And in the retention test, of course, it was a little bit lower as expected. It's almost 7 out of 14. And we see with the simple basic functions following the same pattern, and the more complex functions, the same pattern. Well, the conclusions were that we found poor results in the pretest. So without explicit teaching, many students cannot visualize a graph of even basic functions, or it's a very time-consuming business. In the post-test, the students had improved their recognition, probably to their repertoire of basic functions and of key features, and their qualitative reasoning. And the students themselves indicated that they understood the formulas better. They had more confidence in their own reasoning. They said. We had also a card sorting test in the post-test, and here you see someone working on it. With small cards, and this led to this kind of products, and the different categories more or less look the same for many students as the experts we had in previous studies, and reflected more or less the basic functions in secondary school. We had some problems here. Maybe we were a little bit hard, because this is the category with horizontal and vertical asymptotes with this prototype. and this prototypical graph, and well, you can discuss whether or not these form a different category, more or less the same as on this side with the square root. You see a prototypical formula and a prototypical graph, and well, maybe these form a different category. This one is more easy to indicate. This is not a parabola, not the shape of a parabola, but belongs to this category. And I think that's a simple mistake, not recognizing the parabola. To give you an impression about the card sorting test. In the next study, we investigated the relation between the graphing abilities and the simple sense use in non-routine algebra tasks. And I will show you what it is, a non-routine algebra task. We had two sub-questions. First, are students' graphing abilities positively correlated to their abilities to solve algebra tasks with simple sense? And the second, how is students' simple sense use in graphing formulas similar or different from their simple sense use in solving non-routine algebra tasks? We developed a written simple sense test of 45 minutes with two kinds of tasks, graphing tasks, type A tasks, and algebra tasks, type B tasks. And we had an intervention group of the same intervention group of 21 students and 93 students of five different schools throughout the Netherlands. Here is some examples of the simple sense of the non-routine algebra task. They were about the number of solutions of an equation. You already saw this one. And it was about outcomes of y values. Can it be larger than 70? Or for instance, what outcomes can this have? And probably, where is the maximum value? And inequalities, for example, this one. And approximation of functions when x is very large, this one. We restricted this algebra task to tasks which could be solved with reasoning and graphs. So the students didn't really need any algebraic manipulation. Here's an impression of the graphing tasks. Of course, make a sketch of a graph, the reverse given a graph. Find a formula that fits the graph, and when this is, for instance, the view window of a graphic calculator, and you try to graph this one, are all the characteristics in view? And if not, make a graph of the whole. Well, here an impression of the task, where is the maximum situated, and you see this student is making all kinds of calculations to find the zeros, but it was possible to read the zeros already from the formula. So we said this is not a lack of simple sense. And here is an example of a student who make a graph. So abandon the symbolic representation and worked with the representation and a sign of simple sense and find the correct answer. And we produced three scores, and a graphing score, which we call the TA score, type score on type A questions. Algebra score, TB score, and a simple sense score is whether or not simple sense strategy, like making a graph or recognition of a function family or a key feature, of some kind of reasoning. And we found a positive correlation, rather high correlation coefficient, between the graphing score and the score on the algebra task, and between the graphing score and the symbol sense score. Even when we corrected for the what we call math rating, general math ability, we found more or less the same correlation coefficients. So therefore we concluded a positive correlation between the graphing abilities and the symbol sense use in the algebra tasks. We also did it in another way, based on the graphing scores. We divided the group of the 114 students in four more or less equal groups. The lowest 25%, which was the Q1 group, then the second lowest 25%, Q2, till the 25 highest scoring students, the Q4. And here you see the difference in strategy use on the algebra task between the Q3 and the Q4 students. In task two, here you see task two, you see quite some difference, more symbol sense strategies for the Q4 group. Here, this is on the task three, this is more or less the same situation. And this is on task four, you see quite some difference. And this is an exception. This was the only that was the inequality. Here you see in task five, where the Q3 outperform the Q4 group, and we come to the later. And this is on task eight, and this is on task 14, and you see a very large difference between the two groups. Well, to further explore the reasoning of students and to answer the second sub-question about whether or not students were using their symbol sense in graphing formulas in algebra tasks, we again had the thinking aloud protocols, and we encoded more or less in the same way, with recognition, reasoning, strategic work, and calculation. And we found, for instance, on this task, y cannot be larger than 24 because it's to the power 4 function. Then it's always positive. That is, this form is always positive, so y cannot be larger than 24. That's a correct answer. And it's can the value of this function become larger than 70? Well, first expand the brackets. Can this be larger than 70? I'm going to try to find the turning point, then see whether it is a parabola with a maximum or something like that. But there's also a broken function. Let's see whether it's a parabola, and see whether the turning point is beneath or above 70, and then 40. Does some calculations. No, it doesn't work. I think I calculate some points, but he doesn't. Recognize suddenly there's a vertical asymptote at x is 3. So when x minus 3 is very small, then this part becomes very large and dominate the rest of the function. X min 3 can be infinity small, and then the fraction will be very large and easy above 70. Then we go comes to the inequalities. Inequalities were a big problem for thinking aloud students. Many tried to remember how to deal with inequalities, but this seemed in vain. And surprisingly, they didn't use the symbol strategies like in the other. And here we have an indication of that. I have to think about the inequality sign. when dividing or multiplying by minus or plus, it turns. But I don't remember this. I think when dividing, but I'm not sure. I divide by x, so x minus 1 is smaller than 4. That means it is true for x is 5 and so on. And no correct answer. This is another student. I think I first divide by x, because then it becomes much easier. So x minus 1 is larger than 4, then it's very easy, x is larger than 5. And we see the problems, they try to remember, they don't exactly know, but it's strange that they didn't try to use their simple sense strategies. And maybe previous learned methods hindered students to use the new learned strategies. And further research, I think, is needed to investigate this finding. To answer the second sub-question, we use the following arguments. Graphing formulas is a subset of algebra tasks, and we found a positive correlation between the graphing skills and the simple sense use on algebra tasks. And 16 out of the 21 students who participated in the intervention were in the Q4 group. That isn't strange, of course. If you teach them how to graph formulas, then it will as a result that they are probably better than others who didn't get this teaching. The 6 thinking aloud students, all in the Q4 group, showed how they used their graphing formula simple sense in algebra tasks. They use recognition, reasoning. And this led to the conclusion, students seem to be able to use their simple sense in graph of formulas in a broader domain of non-routine algebra tasks. They seem to be able to transfer their simple sense in a small domain to some broader domain. And to the general conclusion that graphing formulas to qualitative reasoning and recognition might be a practical means to teach simple sense systematically. Well, then some reflection. What did we do? Why might it work? We had the teaching of our simple sense was with a focus and restrictions. We focus only on some aspects of simple sense, essential aspects of simple sense, I think, reading through formulas and making sense of them. And we didn't pay attention on the manipulation of formulas. And we choose a small domain to teach expert strategies. So we enable students to become proficient in, well, some algebra domain. And graphing formulas to qualitative reasoning and recognition pays in a natural way attention to essential aspects of simple sense and recognition of structure, reasoning, qualitative reasoning, and strategic work. And that are exact the things Paul Drijvers mentioned when he talks about simple sense. And this kind of teaching integrates attitude, knowledge, and reasoning skills. And we had a focus on thinking tools, like a repertoire of function families with prototypes and characteristics as large thinking units. So we didn't discuss all the variables, but we use larger thinking units. And of course, qualitative reasoning and questioning the formula are thinking tools as well. And it seems that this graphing formulas is a motivating and challenging task, also for higher achieving students. Well, that I wanted to tell about my PhD research. And then I have some statements for discussion or course, you are invited to bring in other points. But well, let's make some statements. In learning about formulas, the teaching could start with larger thinking units. That is, using function families from the start instead of variables. And probably I have to mention the metaphor I often use when children are learning about houses, they don't need to know what bricks are. It seems that houses are a basic level object. Objects you learn first, and then after this you can learn about the bricks. And maybe it's interesting to investigate whether starting with formulas instead of variables is comparable with learning about houses. Second, for making sense of algebraic formulas, students hardly need manipulations of formulas and expressions. So why not start the teaching of functions with graphing activities instead of the many manipulations which are used at the moment in regular education? And final statement, regular math education lacks the teaching of thinking tools to enable students to learn reading through formulas. And of course, regular math education is very large. And well, when we look, for instance, at the mechanistic approach, which often focus on standard problems, and well, sometimes they make every problem into a standard problem with theory and examples. And in the mechanistic approach, thinking and reasoning doesn't seem very important. On the other hand, when you use innovative approaches, often the focus is on thinking and reasoning, often with the use of technology, but not on the thinking tools, like repertoire of function families, like qualitative reasoning, and so on. And well, you can read something about what I told today in the studies, and of course you are invited to send me an email when you want to receive my complete thesis. Thank you for your attention, and well, I'm anxious to know what you think.
Thank you, Peter. Many small examples and big questions that you have investigated. I feel almost overwhelmed by the variety of different information, but still seems like it all together makes a lot of sense when you conclude with the things. Let's see who has questions. I don't actually see questions in chat for the moment, so you're very welcome to hold to raise your hand here, or even just jump with a comment. Oh, okay. I see Michiel has a raised hand. Please go ahead.
Maybe first, Peter, you can stop presenting, or you want to.
Okay, I will stop.
Well, maybe it's nice to have Peter's points for discussion still on the screen, or not?
Ah, sorry. But I had a different question.
Okay. probably first do this. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
So my question is related to the start of your presentation, when you showed a kind of modeling cycle that also is connected to symbol sense, where you talked about that it's also about learning when to use variables, how to use them, how to manipulate them, and then also how to abandon them and say something again about the problem you started with. And well, the examples that you showed these examples, the equations and the formulas more or less, to me at least, seem to drop out of the air. So it probably for the students, it was not clear where they came from. And I was wondering whether SimpleSense then might be something different than when you are involved in constructing the equation and dealing with the equation to really solve a problem, that in that case, you have another kind of reasoning about the formula and about the symbols than in the examples that you showed.
Mm-hmm. Well, probably I go back to my presentation to show you this slide I was showing. Let's see where. This one. Yep, this one we are talking about.
Yeah,
I think. SimpleSense is very broad, and I think you're talking about this phase, whereas the focus of my research is more on this phase. So, given the formula, so and how to make sense of these formulas. So, of course, I agree when you modeling, that's a different situation. When you are modeling, then the variables can be connected to the real world, and then it's of course easier to understand or probably see the connection between the real world problem and the mathematical problem. So between the variables in the real world and the formulas that you're using. But since my focus was on this phase, and I thought that I could use examples of this phase here. That's why I choose these examples. But I agree, when the focus would have been on this phase, then of course I would have shown some modeling examples and of course the problems students have with the modeling phase.
Yeah, but I even speculate that this vertical solving phase is probably different when it's part from a cycle than when it's when you do it in isolation.
Yeah, of course, I agree. Yeah, of course, if you're running the whole cycle, then of course, when you're working in this phase, that's different than when you don't have this first part of it and you just start instantly in the mathematical problem. Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Okay, so that would be an interesting follow-up study.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Thank you.
And we have Aldine, next one, right?
I'll turn on my microphone. I hope it's on now. Peter, thank you very much for the very interesting talk. As you know, I'm also working on reasoning. So you talk about qualitative reasoning and how being able to recognize families of functions. Well, it's not what you said, but that's what I assume, is that the ability to recognize families of functions helps the students to reason qualitatively. I think it's some kind of interaction, but that's not what you said, but that's what I assume. And but my question is the following. In the end, you said that students appear not when they were to solve like equations of inequalities. They didn't use the SimpleSense strategies, but they relied more on recall. Like, oh, what was it? Oh, I think the fractional exponent is about decreasing. So they were really relying on their memory. So my question is this, if students are more familiar with families of functions, but maybe still make some mistakes in recalling the properties, how as a teacher can you help students to decide, can I rely on my memory, or should I use these SimpleSense strategies that I also have? because both of them are very powerful. Recognition is powerful, symbol sense strategy is powerful, but you have to choose when to rely on which. So what can you do as a teacher?
In my Math A class, I always said, when you are doubting to whether to use your memory or whether to use your common sense, choose the last one. But that isn't so easy. I think in this case of inequations, is something from very long ago, and in that phase of their education, it wasn't linked to, for instance, graphs. To explain about inequalities, it's very powerful to use graphs, and it seems that they didn't interpreted inequations in terms of graphs, and that says something about the teaching of the inequalities. So probably I would suggest always use graphs, and sometimes you can do without, but most of the time not. Many students should use the graphs and not try to shorten the path to the solution, because I think that is what's happening all the time in many classrooms. They're running to the fast solutions, but take some time to make sense of what you're doing. So is that an answer to your question? Yeah.
Thanks, Alden. Is there anybody whom I don't see the hand? And maybe while you're thinking, I have a question. I think it's related to Michiel's question, actually, that was before. When you say, like, we teach them to make sense of formulas, you kind of identify making sense with the possibilities to sort graphs, as I sensed. And I was wondering, is it so, or do I miss something, and why should we consider it as making sense? Do you expect them, once they aligned a function and a graph, that they can actually reason further about it to some everyday situations or whatever?
Can you repeat it?
So my main question, do you consider recognizing or building a graph of a formula as a sufficient evidence, or as something that is making sense?
No, yeah. I don't think that. No, then you should maybe use the term make graphical sense.
Yeah,
consider to use that description. Making sense is probably more than just having a graph, the formulas are very abstract to many students, and the graph is more concrete. And of course, the graph isn't exactly is only representation of a function and a formula as well, you get more the feeling what the function is doing.
If you are able to read graphs.
Yeah, and that gives you, I think, more concrete possibility to think and to reason with it, mm-hmm. instead of just the A's and the B's and the X and Y's. That's why I think that it's helpful to make sense of what you are doing. And even in calculus, I was surprised that some students, when I asked if you can't make a graph, how do you solve these calculus problems, for instance? And he said, we just use our methods. And that makes me think that As a teacher, I make graphs on the blackboard and I say, well, you see here something like this and this. But I wonder since then if they really see the same things that I see. For instance, when we have a prototypical natural logarithm graph, we see it's going to infinity. We see the vertical asymptote. But I wonder if our grade 11 students do see things like that. Probably we have to be more careful and teaching the students to use more the graphical representation in algebraic problems and see and really explain what they are seeing and discussing it with them, because at the moment, well, I thought after this series of lessons, I think, well, I did something, but it didn't make sense for them what I did on the backboard. All the time, of course, but in quite some situations, I think, and not for all the students, but for quite some students.
Thanks. So here you were about making graphical sense, but then there is an issue of making sense of the graphs, and that's further on. Yeah. Thanks. I see Rohir has a hand. Would you like to?
Yes, I hope. Well, thanks, Peter. I think it was a very nice presentation, very interesting. I really like the subject. And maybe I have a question, an additional question to what I've seen, or maybe I've misremembered some things. But I do think I remember mostly situations where sort of algebraic reasoning supported understanding the graphical part, but the other way around, maybe I just have to be reminded, or maybe you can present some extra examples of where the graphical aspects really support the reasoning in an algebraic problem. I'm sure you must have presented them, but then again, I couldn't reproduce them. So give me an example where the students get an algebraic problem and they're really helped by the fact that they know how to graph the involved function.
I think these examples, you don't mean these examples? In this case, the graph helps to reason about the algebraic problem, I think.
Yeah, but take the first one. Sorry to interrupt, but the first one is that an algebraic problem to begin with?
I think so. Why not?
Well, it's not an algebraic equation, so to say. It's sort of transcendental. We know immediately that there will not be an algebraic solution to it. So to me, this is always, in a sense, it's not yet really an algebraic problem. Maybe more the fourth then.
Well, then if you say it is because of there is no algebraic solution, then this one has an algebraic solution. So this one should fit your definition of an algebraic problem.
And how does it help me here then to have the visual interpretation, because here it's tempting to indeed just solve it algebraically.
Maybe. Well, if you make a graph of 2 in the power x, which is increasing, and this one is decreasing, then you know there can be only one solution.
Give the number. Yes, so then again, is it then an algebraic problem to begin with?
Just a second. It feels like you have two different definitions of algebraic problems, don't you?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe that's my question in the end. So when do you even classify a problem as an algebraic problem?
Algebraic problem. I think. Can I give an instant and give you a definition? That's well. Do you not think maybe because you think about algebraic manipulations. Is that algebra for you?
No, maybe I'm looking for a problem that would have a solution by algebraic means, but would be a lot facilitated if you would use your your graphical skills.
Well, then I say number three fits in your definition. Number four, I think, but number five as well. But number seven.
Yeah, it's just as I'm sorry. Perhaps for some people this is boring because it's a repetition of what you already said. But to me, this really helps to have a look again at these problems. And so maybe I'll just continue have a look at this and we answer another problem question. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Rohir. I think it's a clarification of what actually is meant. And Ad has a further question on the motivation. Could you speak it out, please?
Yes, I have a question to Peter, and thank you for your presentation. I will use it when I have a class of students who are becoming a teacher. I'll try to use it. But I have a question about the change in attitude to algebra, because you, I saw in your presentation that you measured the change in motivation. So you wanted to integrate attitude, knowledge base, and reasoning skills. But did you measure something like that? Did you measure something about the attitude? Because in my experience, pupils think about students think about algebra in a kind of calculations with variables or with letters instead of so maybe they feel more confident when you can't make some small calculating mistakes. So I should expect they feel more confident in your global approach.
Yeah, I think many students have the image of algebra as making calculations, and I think I broaden that scope a little bit. We didn't tell the students that they didn't need manipulations, so they were just sitting there and expecting problems which could be solved with calculations or could be solved with graphs and reasoning. So in that that point, they didn't expect very special things. We didn't measure the attitude. We only saw the thinking aloud students, and the attitude of not instantly starting with calculations. Well, you saw, I'm not sure whether Rogier is already finished with this things, yeah. But in this case, for instance, you see they started the calculations, but then consider their strategies. So the attitude of first look at it and consider some strategies. We did find that with the students, more in the post-test than in the pre-test, of course. But we didn't measure anything about the attitude. No. So that statement was from the thinking aloud protocols.
Okay. Well, I am interested in if you can get a change in the attitude.
Because I think we saw we only had one simple sense test, so we couldn't compare it with other things. No, and we saw that the students of the intervention did use more this kind of strategies considerations than the other students. So they seem to learn something about it, but
And also eager to try it further, right? So although you didn't measure, but seems that they were ready to try it. Then there is a next question from, I'm sorry about pronouncing the name, Desire, on a historical perspective. Could you jump in, please?
Nice try with the name, thank you. Yeah, Peter, of course, for me, you could expect a question like this, but it is I'm genuinely interested if you might have looked at this from an historical perspective, since the concept of graph and the study of curves have developed in a certain way, and does it align with what you have found with your students?
No, maybe your expertise we need for this, and work together on something like that. That would be interesting. No, I didn't have any thing from the historical perspective. No, I'm sorry.
Okay, I'm not an expert, so I was hoping maybe you could enlighten me.
No.
Yeah, Rahir has some following up. Kiana, do you have a question? Kiana? Yeah.
Kuna,
yeah. Sorry. Yeah, that's I could know.
Peter, thank you. I enjoyed it, and I think it's a very important topic. You ended with a sort of recommendation or proposal, I'm not sure. Start with large thinking units instead of variables. And your argument was about houses and bricks, I think. I'm not very fond of that kind of metaphors. I think given some time, I could find a metaphor that proves the inverse. So could you elaborate on this point? Why do you think this is a good idea?
Well, I think many of my students get lost in the numbers and letters they have met during their mathematical career in secondary school. So they pay attention to every letter, every number in a formula. And to see structure, which helps, of course, to get more grip on formulas, it's easier to use some bigger and larger thinking units. So my idea is that because of large formulas in which you have to pay attention to everything, you make other units. For instance, when you compare it with making programs for computers, I was one of the first who did some programming, and we were discussing about the points and the commas and so on. Later, it was more using modules, and put them together. And I think, you see, for instance, building houses are not with bricks. All walls are coming to us. So when time is progressing, it seems that in many domains, larger units are used. And I think it will be helpful for students to not to pay attention to every detail, but to looking at the whole and have a global view of the elements that plays a role. So is that some answer in your direction?
I can follow that, but I'm still have the feeling those units still are effect functions, and they are coming from somewhere. So there must be some history in the teaching. And I think you can do a lot with error language, with making chunks and making more details, and then go back and forth and see how it works. So I would prefer that kind of growth instead of going too quickly to the bigger chunks.
Well, that's probably what I suggested, to just to start with the bigger chunks, and sometimes, and it is of course important that you put a hammer on the chunks and to make them smaller. Now we're starting to build, and we're losing many students in building our problem and making a hole at the end. And yes. Probably even, I think, when you, for instance, teaching some new subject, it's quite difficult for students to make the hole afterwards, after you put a whole lot of details into them, and then say, well, they are all together. So probably that's why we're using whole tasks. Start with the whole, and if necessary, break it down. And of course, with those larger units, you can still use the arrows and chaining the different components, I think. So.
Yeah. Well, it's a matter of balance, I guess. But,
of course, that will always be. But now, I think at this moment, we're still building with very small elements.
Yeah, I agree. That's too refined and too fussy, and so that could be done better. Yeah.
Thank you. That was interesting discussion. That is actually not a solo statement, but an issue of a history of where we are in this peninsula, and on the which contrasting cases and how to change. I saw Michiel. The hand once again. Michiel, is it something you'd like to share?
Well, the only thing was that the longer I think of the examples you show, and also what you say, that students don't see the structure, so the stronger I think that we are really expecting too much from them, especially these examples with the where you had the parabolic plus fraction, but you couldn't see immediately that it was a parable because it was already factorized. Or
do I have to show you?
And when such a formula is suddenly given to, at least to me, but also to students, and they are coming from a biology class or, I don't know, from gymnastics, and then are confronted with an equation like that, and we expect them to see structure suddenly, that I'm not sure whether that's fair and whether we need to, well, create education that makes them do that. Because I think it's almost impossible.
Oh, well,
and maybe not useful.
That's, I can't comment on that.
In general, these numbers and these pieces of the equation have different, you're looking on a certain dimension, so you're looking in long behavior or on a very small scale, and then parts of it are important and parts can be neglected. And that's helpful in trying to make sense of what is there. But when everything has the same value, it's almost, yeah, it's, I'm not sure whether we need to ask that from students to be able to make sense of an equation in that way.
And can you give me an example? Because
Well, the example of y equals and then x minus 3 times x minus 2, and there was also a minus before, and then plus or minus, and then some, a fraction with x minus 3 in the.
So, yeah. Do you mean, just re-ask maybe to clarify also, so do you mean that even to understand these equations, a lot of manipulative skills already needed?
Yeah, I'm not sure whether in our secondary education, as an equation like this, I try to type.
Yeah, I'm not sure Peter has access to chat, so.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, something like this, I think. And then even there was a decimal in it, or it was more complicated. But when all elements here have the same value, I'm not sure whether we need to try to solve the problem or try to develop symbol sense to make in our students to make sense of expressions like this when there is no context at all. Or would you agree with that or not?
Can you share the screen with us?
It is still just a complicated expression, like one of that you had multiplied of brackets plus something divided with the bracket.
Okay. Well, I think we can teach our students, not say quite easy, but well, rather easy, this kind of looking through the formula and seeing what is important and what isn't in a certain problem situation, because in other problem situation there will be other things important. I don't agree with you that we couldn't teach them this kind of things. If it's useful, that's another discussion. But looking through formulas.
That's part of the question, of course. It needs a lot of effort, and then there's the question of the balance: is the effort worth the time needed to reach it, that level of comprehension?
Well, I think looking through formulas, for instance, in physics education, use a lot of qualitative reasoning as well. And of course, maybe this is an extreme example, but in general, well, I don't think we used very fancy formulas, except maybe from this one. But
We agreed upon the difference between formulas dropping out of the air and when there is a context where they come from.
Yeah, but I think many students and me as well, we see a lot of formulas maybe related to some realistic context, but not exactly do we know how they are related. They're coming from the context, and then we have make sense of the formula. And in that case, I think you have to look through the formula, and you can't see how the different parts of the formula are connected to the problem situation, the realistic problem situation. And of course, if you can, that's then you have a different problem.
Okay.
Thanks, Michiel. It's maybe always the most difficult question, what is, should be in curriculum at all or not. I don't see more hands apart from Rohir. So Rohir, please, maybe last comment, and we actually need to end close this. Mike, your mic?
Yeah, small detail. Officially we finish now, but if no one minds, I was just triggered by in one of your slides you mentioned a paper by Paul Kirschner, 10 Steps to Complex Learning, a New Approach to Instruction and Instruction Design. I never heard of that paper, and I was just wondering how it played a role in your instructional design.
I use this as a design principles, because we thought that graphing formulas was a complex skill because of the many different formulas out of the blue, as Michiel said. And they advise to use a whole task with help and reflection. And so that we try to build in our intervention. And well, with the whole task, we had some help. I give you some impression of some tasks with the help. And reflections tasks were often find some examples of, to show that you understand what's going on. So for instance, we had in the task four about recognizing the key features from the formulas, and then students had to give three examples in which they show formulas where they could easily read the zeros of the function, for instance. So create their own examples. And that we they handed in all their own examples, which we corrected, and we gave feedback on it. So that's the role of Kirschner and Marian Boer.
Yeah, I'm going to have a look at that. Thank you.
It's interesting. Interesting paper.
So, shall we call it a day?
Yes, I think. Thank you very much, Peter. And
we can actually switch on our mics, and I really enjoy giving an applause to the speaker, even though it's not a bit silly compared to real applause, but let's try.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. It was my pleasure.
Yes, and then we see you next time in about a month on the 12th of November, and the announcement of who will be there is coming soon, and the video of this record will be online as usual.
Yes, thank you for being here today.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your attention.
Are you happy, Peter, with how it went?
Yeah. I didn't know what questions I should expect, but it's okay. Yeah, interesting.
Yeah.
Stuff to think about, of course.
Ah, great.
That's I'm happy. Good. Yeah.
Normally you get a little present, but we owe you a present.
No. And I was wondering. Was it too fast, my talking, or?
I think no. The tempo was very good. Yeah, for the future of online presentations, I think we shall introduce, Ruhil, that something more in between of us to discuss, like three steps presentation, 15 minutes, a little bit of questions, 15 minutes, a little bit of questions, because it's hard for you also, I guess, to talk for so long when you are not in a direct interaction. And a little bit hard to listen sometimes because you stop feeling where you are in the story, right? Yeah. But I think that was a really good temper and well articulated material. Yes, I enjoyed it. Yeah.
You noticed that there were lots of questions from people, so that generally means that they they were relevant questions, so that means that they understood what was at stake.
Yeah.
By the way, I have. Go ahead, sorry.
Well, probably your idea for 50 minutes and then some questions and then 50 minutes again. It's for the people who are listening as well, I think, attractive. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think so. It will make it a little bit more of a different thing. Yeah. By the way, I have still a burning question. Can I drop on you?
Yeah.
I was very curious. I'm generally super curious about these retention tests, like you did immediately, and then after 4 months, after a summer, that's like really interesting. And you showed general statistics, kind of, that dropped, but still was good. But you didn't explain in detail what was, like, which aspects were lost and which were preserved.
Let's see. I didn't have thinking aloud things data from the retention test. So I didn't want to again come to the same six students.
Ah, so you basically can't say too much.
But when you look at the statistics, you see that especially the basic simple functions, they were still they still could recognize those function families with almost 5 out of 7. So they really improved their abilities to graph basic functions and basic function families, and that they still remember after the summer.
Interesting.
And well, the complex functions they didn't. Improve on the complex function. They still had problems, for instance, with adding two subgraphs or multiplying two subgraphs.
Interesting.
So they came further in the problem solving, but the end, when to combine all the information, then there they make many mistakes.
Interesting. Thank you, because it actually means that they really relied on their visual memory quite a lot and not so much procedural tricks.
No. Well, that was maybe the thing that's why I said to Michiel that I was much more optimistic that we can learn our students this kind of reasoning. They seem to more to rely on their reasoning abilities and the small repertoire of basic functions, and they didn't learn any tricks. And I think from the reactions afterwards, because after the final exam, I interviewed 2-3 of the students again, and they advised me what to do with this. And they said, well, start earlier and build it up. And they really get more confidence in their own reasoning. And that's something, what I learned from it. We can teach students in a way that they get some confidence in their own reasoning.
And reasoning, yeah. And they, yeah. Okay, that's very nice. Interesting. Thanks. Yeah. I just think like we need really to rely on this retention tests, because we don't want them to forget all of it in 2 months, right? So yeah.
And of course, maybe from the point of research, of course, when I was teaching, this class the whole time. So probably during the other lessons, some of these aspects of reasoning and so on is, well, happens. I didn't have teaching of the graphing formulas formally, but informally, of course, when you solve a problem, well, think a little bit. And I remember that one student proudly said, well, I make some sketch by myself from x times x in the power minus x square. And he did it just by himself because he felt he could do it now. So.
Nice. No, that's very nice. Yeah, that's rewarding experience.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you.
My pleasure.
Yeah. By the way, last question I wanted to ask, would you like, because sometimes we do, sometimes not, to put a presentation online. We will put video, but I just, if you would like to share slides, we're also welcoming it, but not necessarily.
Okay, I will send it to you. If you want to, I will send it.
Yeah, it's just nice to have material of seminar so that people can come back if needed. Yeah.
Okay.
Some reference and so on. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Good. Perfect.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks.